Today, we're going to be having a look at an innovation ETF by ARK Invest called ARKK. Previously, we had a look at a space exploration by the same guys called ARKX. And basically, as the name suggests, that ETF is all about space and the related technologies around space exploration. And if you want to have a look at that video, the link should be somewhere right here. Now, ARKK is more of a general innovation-based ETF that focuses on lots of different industries, not just one. And we'll have a look at this in just a second. Hey guys, my name is Faizy and this channel is about finance and investing. As usual, this video is not financial advice. I'm not a financial advisor. Please make sure to do some of your own research as well. Don't just fully rely on myself. This video is just for general reference. Let's get into it. Now guys, if you're not familiar with ARK Invest, they're basically led by CEO and investor Cathie Wood, and essentially a lot of her ETFs have delivered insane returns and they've beaten the market for sure by many times. This company is of course based in the US. Now what makes ARK Invest different than most other ETF providers out there is the fact that they mostly have actively managed ETFs, meaning that the fund managers do lots and lots of research to find those innovative companies that can hopefully do well in the future. And secondly, they look for innovation above anything else, and that's the number one criteria for most of their ETFs. So as you can see, based on this timeline, innovation came from lots of different things, especially when you look at it in the past, right? So we can see that before we had the steam engine in the 1700s, then we had the internal combustion engine, telephone, airplane, television, and then towards the 1970s and onwards, we can see that it started to get much more digitized and much more computerized, if that makes sense. So we can see that we had the microprocessor, mobile phones, internet, and so on. And looking at 2003, we can see that the first human genome was sequenced. And look, to be honest, I'm not too sure what this means exactly, but I'm pretty sure that it's based in the whole genomics industry side of things, where they tried to change DNA or something like that. I'm not too sure. I'm going to do some research on it, because ARK Invest also has an ETF in this space called ARKG, which focuses on genomics innovation. So as we sit right now at the present timeline, ARK has basically identified these five different industries when it comes to leading us into the future. So we can see that you've got next-gen internet, DNA sequencing, automation, energy storage, and of course, blockchain. So ARK is basically saying that the next stage of innovation lies within these sorts of industries, and ARK wants to position its investments to ensure that they can take advantage of these industries moving forward. And because of this, if you have a look at the ARK website, as you can see right here, they have lots of different ETFs in these types of industries. So you've got, you know, ARKK, which is the first ETF right here. Then you have autonomous tech and robotics, next-gen internet, genomics, fintech, and space. So there's lots of different ETFs for each type of niche. So looking at ARKK in much more detail, we can see that the objective of this is to get that long-term capital growth. And this is, of course, not an income-based ETF at all. And basically what they're saying is that they want to benefit from the overall growth of innovation around the world. Now, as I mentioned before, this ETF is an actively managed ETF, meaning that each of the companies are carefully chosen. So the fund managers of this ETF are looking to invest about 65% of their assets into domestic and foreign companies that fit this general innovation theme. Now we can see that there's actually quite a lot of companies and industries included in this general innovation theme. Like we've got genomics, industrial innovation, next-gen internet, and fintech is also included. So this ETF is a bit of a mixed bag, if you guys get what I mean. There's lots of industries and lots of companies combined. Now, ARK defines these industries as being at the edge of disruptive innovation. And basically what that means is that this type of industries and these types of innovations have the potential to change the world as we know it. Now, look, that sounds pretty dramatic, but let me give you guys an example. The invention of the internet and then subsequently the invention of the Wi-Fi, apparently this was invented in Australia, but you can definitely agree that this was an absolute game changer for every single person around the world, and they've essentially changed every single person's lives for the better and for the worse. You can basically communicate with any single person out there around the world. As long as they have a steady internet connection, you can do so many things with the power of the internet. You can work remotely, you can run a business from your smartphone, from your laptop remotely, and there's so many different possibilities. There's been a huge rise of digital nomadism, which means that you can literally work from anywhere around the world as long as you have a laptop and an internet connection. And it's basically enabled me to do what I'm doing right now, which is making these videos for people to see online. So ARK is trying to focus on the next generation of internet companies as an example, with companies in this space including stuff like e-commerce, online streaming, gaming and AI, so you can see how important this stuff actually is for the future of internet and where things are going. Now, this sort of stuff can hopefully bring change at a massive level around the world. Now, we're gonna have a look at the returns for this ETF and see just how much it's outperformed the S&P 500 by, but before we do, as usual, if you have found any sort of value so far, please leave a like or subscribe. It really does help out. Let's get into it. So jumping into the returns for the ETF, we can see that the year-to-date return is negative 3.7%, so obviously it's not doing too well for the time being, but having a look at a bigger time frame at the 1 year return, it is quite decent at 37%, which is not too bad at all. Having a look at the absolute max return since the ETF was listed, the max return is about nearly 500%, which is pretty good. It's definitely gone up quite insanely, and it's definitely beating the market for sure. However, let's dissect the performance of this ETF even more. So if we compare the ETF to the bottom of the March crash that we saw last year to the price now, we can see that the return has been quite phenomenal at 217%, so the price has really gone up quite a bit here. Now, if we compare it to the highs that we saw this year, the return is even insane at about 300%, which is again, not bad at all. If we just look a bit in depth into the year-to-date data, we can see that from the year-to-date high to the year-to-date low, the return has been quite devastating at negative 36%. So you can really see that with actively managed ETFs like this, you are gonna see insane price fluctuations where you would not see the same sort of fluctuation if you just bought into a normal S&P 500 ETF. And lastly, if we compare the year-to-date high to the price now, the return has been about negative 23%. So if you did buy the ETF at the wrong time, you would be sitting at a loss right now. So you can of course see that year to date, the ETF is not doing too well. The holdings inside the ETF have obviously declined this year, but I just wanna remind you guys to have a long-term approach to investing and don't worry about the fluctuations of just a year too much. But I also wanna compare this to the S&P 500 and show you guys the difference of return. So this is the S&P 500, and for the 1 year, it's been fairly stable. We can see that it's returned about 32% for just the 1 year, which is not too bad either. Compare that to ARK once again, the return has been 37%. So even though ARK has beaten the S&P 500, it is much, much more volatile. It's basically gone up this mountain right here, then it's come back down again. So it's not stable by any means. Looking at the year to date for the S&P 500, however, and we can see that year to date, it's been pretty good at about 21% positive. And once again, if we compare it to the ARK ETF, the year-to-date return is sitting at a negative, so you can really see the insane difference of ARK versus the normal market. Now, that's the thing with ETFs like ARK, because these types of ETFs are not really following a specific index. They're actively managed, and you will see deviations like this, which are pretty huge. Because the holdings are individually selected, they're not going to outperform every single time, so that's why you will see this volatility and big differences between the normal indexes and just the ETF's returns. And lastly, if we just compare both of the prices of the ETFs on top of each other, we can see that the yellow line is of course the S&P, the blue is the ARK Innovation ETF, and we can see that the returns for both of the ETFs basically equaled around that May point, right? So all the insane returns that the ARK ETF got basically got diminished in just about 2 months. So if you just bought any of the ETFs at the start of the year, you would have basically made the same amount of money. However, if we switch to a 5 year time frame, things start to look way different, right? So you can see that the ARK ETF has been outperforming the S&P by a couple of 100%, which is definitely very good. And it's a whole different story, which is why I always tell people to take a long-term approach with investing. Don't look at it in terms of weeks or months or even years. Look at it in terms of many years, if that makes sense. Now, the whole point of this comparison was to show you guys the implications of looking at an actively managed ETF versus a passive index tracking ETF. They both have the pros and cons, and hopefully this allows you guys to make a proper decision. I'm not telling you to buy either ETF. I'm just telling you to look at these two returns and make your decision based on this as well. Because if you are someone who's looking at those actively managed ETFs, it is good to have a benchmark to have a look at it. So you could use a benchmark such as the NASDAQ 100 or the S&P 500, or for the Australian share market, you could use ASX 200 or ASX 300 as a baseline. Having a general look at the fund details, we can obviously see that the ticker is ARK. The fund type is an actively managed ETF. The primary exchange is the New York Stock Exchange, ARKA Exchange. But for us though, it doesn't really make too big of a difference because we can use any broker that offers American shares to buy this sort of ETF. Personally, I have bought into this ETF and I've done so using Stake. The good thing about Stake though is that they do offer brokerage-free trades on US stocks only, which is very good because as Australians, all we really know is paying brokerage, whereas over in the US, they have commission-free trading, and Stake have basically brought commission-free trading to Australia, but of course there's other brokers out there that do the same thing. If you do want to check out Stake though, there should be a link in the description, and you'll also be getting a free stock for Nike, GoPro, or Dropbox. You can basically spin the wheel and get a free stock, which is just a goodie for you and me. The inception date is October 2014, and ARK basically launched quite a few ETFs during that time. So ARKK is basically one of the oldest ETFs of ARK, you could say. The net assets is 25 billion, and the expense ratio is 0.75%, which turns out to be a fee of $75 per 10K invested. And personally, if you ask me, it's not bad at all for an actively managed ETFs. Some actively managed ETFs charge you over 1% management fee per year, plus an outperformance fee as well if they outperform the benchmark, right? So as an example, if the outperformance fee is 20%, you're gonna be paying 20% of whatever the outperformance is, if that makes sense. So if the index returned, let's say 10% a year, and the ETF returned 11%, the outperformance is that 1% portion, and you'll be paying 20% of 1%. So in this sort of model, the fund manager obviously has more incentive to make the right choices and to outperform, but then you do end up paying for it as well. And if the fund manager can't outperform, then you're stuck with paying the fee no matter what. So seeing a fee of 0.75% is pretty good, no doubt. Having a look at the typical holdings, it is 35 to 55. And obviously that's gonna be pretty different to the broad market ETFs that you're used to, where the ETF holdings are basically a couple of hundred to even up to 500 to a couple thousand with some other ETFs. And as you can see, the holdings of just 55 makes the ETF very concentrated because it's just including the top innovators in this space, and as I mentioned before, these innovators aren't going to perform all the time. And these number of holdings will fluctuate with time as a team does more and more research and adds companies and takes companies out of the ETF. Speaking of holdings, let's actually take a look. So first off, we've got Tesla at about 11% weighting, which is pretty huge. Cathie Wood has been pretty vocal about Tesla, and she's pretty bullish on it as well. So that's obviously demonstrated by the first holding that this ETF has, and it still seems this way because the holding is of 13 August. So it's pretty recent. And we can see Teladoc at second place, and they basically offer virtual healthcare services, another big company to look out for. Then we have Roku, Coinbase, which was basically the newest IPO, and they've allocated 5% towards it, which is of course quite a big deal because it's the fourth largest holding. Then if you go down a bit, you've got Zoom, Square, Shopify. All three of these companies have done quite well during the pandemic, of course, with remote working, cardless transactions, the e-commerce business boom, where with Shopify, basically any person can open up an online store, and they've made it very democratized and very easy for people to just start selling stuff online. Then you've also got other names like Palantir and Spotify, and you'll also see that there's no traditional tech names on here like Amazon, Apple, Netflix, Google, you know, like the FANG stocks. It's very different, and you've got these other types of companies that are going to be hopefully innovators in the future. So basically, if you want a tech ETF that doesn't really focus on those traditional tech names, this ETF may be worth looking at. By the way, if you are wondering what FANG actually is, I've done a whole video on the FANG ETF that's listed on the ASX. That ETF was actually a top performer of 2020, so go check that video out. There should be a link somewhere here, and that video will basically explain everything to you. Having a brief look at the tech breakdown, we can see that it's mostly digital stuff. We've got cloud computing, e-commerce, digital media, and that basically makes up around 35% of the ETF's holdings. Then you've also got mobile, big data, Internet of Things, and some robotic stuff. So really it's gonna make up about half of the ETF's holding. Looking at the market cap, we can see that the focus is mostly on those large cap companies between $10 to $100 billion worth of market capitalization. And there's not too much of a focus on those mega caps at 100 billion plus. In comparison, it's only 25%. And that's also due to the fact that there's no FANG stocks in this ETF's holding. The sector breakdown is about 1/3 IT, which is of course pretty expected because this is an innovation based ETF. Then we also have healthcare at about 30%, and you might be wondering why the healthcare side is that big, and that's mostly due to Teladoc and some other companies operating in that gene therapy and genomic space. The geography is focused towards North America at about 88%. Look, no surprises here, it's pretty expected. Most of these companies are gonna be in America and Canada. Now personally, I love the innovation space because you can potentially see where the world is heading, and you can get a glimpse of it if the ARK team is correct with their predictions. And these companies are potentially at the forefront of what's going to happen. And look, I keep saying potentially because nobody can 100% predict the future. Now, as I mentioned before, I've personally bought into ARKK myself, but do not take this as financial advice. Don't just buy into it because I'm buying it. Please make sure to do your own research as well. form your own thesis and have this ETF a part of your portfolio only when you've done the research. Now, we're also going to be having a look at some other ARK ETFs in the future as well. But in the meantime, do check out this video, which is the ARKX ETF. This is obviously the space exploration ETF. And of course, with Jeff Bezos and Richard Branson blasting themselves into space, this is once again pretty exciting. So check this video out. And guys, thank you so much for watching. Please like and subscribe, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye now. Companies are going to be in